boklansering, boksamtale i regi av Kvinnefronten og Bergen offentlige bibliotek. Kvinnefronten har besøk av Rachel Moran fra Irland, som skal snakke om den boka dere ser bak her, som dere også sikkert vet. Jeg heter Charlotte Myrbråten og er akkurat begynt å jobbe som prosjektleder ved Bergen bibliotek. Så hvis noen av dere har lyst å gjøre lignende arrangementer her, så er det bare å ta kontakt. Hvis noen av dere også føler for å skrive noe på internett mens dere sitter her, så ser dere at det er litt informasjon bak det her i hjørnet. Og så kanskje dere kan bruke hashtaggen paid for hvis dere føler for det. Da er det egentlig bare å gi ordet til Agnete Strøm fra Kvinnefronten, så ta runden derfra. Yep.
Yes, it is a joint venture between the Women's Front and the Public Library here in Bergen, but we also have other good supporters, especially economical support from FO, the trade union, the three parties, the Party Red, the Party Social Left Party, and the Labour Party. So this is a joint venture with those partners that have also been fighting for the law that criminalized the buying of sex in Norway that came about in 2009. So we are here today also to welcome you, Rachel. When Chico Ali and I heard you in New York the 5th of March this year, we decided that the Women's Front had to invite you to Bergen so that we could share you with others. And even more eager were we when we understood that you had a book coming out soon. And the book, Paid For, was launched the 12th April in Dublin, Ireland, barely 1.5 months ago. The book is brand new, and you are a brand new author also. Even if you have been writing on bits of papers, on receipts, on tickets, etc. since your early childhood. But for years, you, Rachel Moran, experienced nothing but powerlessness. You experienced prostitution, you were homeless, you were an addict. In your book, Paid For, your remarkable memoir, you have faced facts, uncovered hurt, and you have taken a cold, hard look at the experience that shaped you. You describe your background, and coming from a dysfunctional home life, you always felt utterly set apart from mainstream society. And a troubled family life led to educational disadvantage and adolescent homelessness. A familiar story and one that primed you for life as a prostituted woman. Your story, your book, expose the violent, lonely, relentlessly exploitative reality of prostitution. And you also tell the stories of innumerable other women. But you left that world behind, got back to education, and spent 10 years writing a truly original, painfully honest account of the realities of your experience. You give us all of your knowledge, all of your relentless thinking, rethinking, and the hard work of grasping your own lived experiences and transform them to words on paper. In finally telling your story, you have achieved the ultimate power of all, the truth. In your own words, in your own name. Welcome to you, Rachel Moran.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for the warm welcome. I'm just going to read a couple of pages here from near the start of the book that just explain why I chose to write in my own name. I considered the issue of anonymity, and I wondered if secrecy and shame are the threads woven together to make up the fabric of this garment, and secrecy dissipates upon disclosure, does the garment itself disintegrate? Will revealing my identity possibly in any way free me of shame? Would that it might, but shame exposed is not shame dispersed. In my darker moments, I think identifying myself will only change the texture of this garment and have it emerge in a new incarnation, a single threaded fabric, consisting simply of shame which has been laid bare. Which is true, maybe both are, and it is a pointless wondering. I could never get comfortable with the idea of writing this book anonymously, though. I felt that to write it publicly was simply to share the shame between myself and my son and the rest of our family. Yet I could find no peace in anonymity, so for a long time I was troubled. I just wanted to tell the truth, but how could I consider my account truthful if it were stamped on the cover page with a name that was not my own? Would I not have been guilty of presenting its readers with a dishonesty before they'd even opened the fourth page? Publishing this account under a pseudonym felt to me for a long time as though I had accepted the challenge of telling the truth and had failed at the first hurdle. I resented it dreadfully. Over and over I paired my first name together with a multitude of surnames in an effort to find a pseudonym. I did this because I thought if I kept my first name, I wouldn't feel so badly about not being able to publish it under my full name. It didn't work, and on reflection, why should it? My first name paired with any other is still not my name. I felt there was no arguing with the necessity of a pseudonym, and yet there was no end to that nagging conviction that to have my account published under any name would be not to bear witness fully, to not own my account fully. I could find no peace in being represented by any of these names. What to do about that? Eventually an answer came. I would use my partner's surname. The moment he suggested it, I knew it was the only name in the world I would not present on the cover of this book. So there it was, and that was fine. Except he and I broke up during the writing of the book, and I was back to square one, wondering what to call myself. I decided to end the mental struggle and to choose a name that expressed qualities I liked. Queen Maeve was an Irish warrior queen, and I know that the truths I'm presenting here will fly in the face of a lot of the nonsense that circulated about prostitution. So I felt I could do with a bit of her energy. Also, folklore has it that Queen Maeve once demanded an interlude during battle because she got her period. She was not prepared, even by nature itself, to be put at an unfair disadvantage to the men. I liked her style. I've always thought the surname Conway had a certain melodic ring to it and felt it nice, it sat nicely, with Maeve. I found, when looking up the meaning of Conway, that it had two possible meanings, one being fearsome warrior, so the name seemed to fit well together. Yet even though I'd settled on a pseudonym, that did not quell certain fears of mine about making these truths public. If examining the truth about prostitution has been one type of pain, laying these truths before the public is another. This former type of pain has accompanied me constantly through every line I've written, and it will only leave after I've typed the last full stop. Thinking about actually publishing the book, laying these truths before the public, is a different kind of pain, and it is made up of different components. There is a constant low-level negative feeling, the fears and paranoia of being exposed. There is a sense of defensiveness, the expectation of being judged. There is, of course, shame. Today that feels as if it is abating, but not all days are like this one. And shame, I have come to find, is more stubborn than grief. Shame does not ebb away slowly over time. So it sometimes hides its face for a while, seeming to slink out of sight, only to stride purposefully back out of the shadows and onto the centre stage of your life, as real and alive as it was the first day you saw it. Grief can and does pull this nasty little stump too, but it has not the persistence or longevity of shame. I imagine shame to wear a mask, like something you'd see at Halloween. Its image is always ugly. I cannot see it very clearly today, but I know that does not mean it has gone away. I have decided not to wear a mask here, not even one I like in some ways, because to take my mask off is my way of confronting shame and daring it to do the same thing. That is why I've decided to tell the world my name is Rachel Moran.
Thank you. Thank you, Rachel. I would like to pick up on two things that you said here. You said in the beginning of your quote, you said there are no, you found no peace in anonymity. And, in, and over, and in the last piece, sentence also, you say that to confront shame. And that brings us clearly straight into the topic. And I would like to ask you, Rachel, can you discuss what are some of the key myths that surround prostitution, and perhaps begin with the idea that prostitution is a function of choice? And think about that, what she recently read.
Okay. Now, can you hear me? Is this working? Mm-hmm. Yeah?
Yeah.
I suppose some of the more common myths would be the happy hooker, the high class hooker, and the notions of autonomy and sexual self-determination in prostitution. And to be quite honest, when I answer these questions, it's just as well I feel nice and relaxed today. If I get a day where my nerves are a little bit frayed, that's not the day to ask me those questions, because they're intensely irritating and frustrating. And they're also, when you have these things put to you, not by you, of course, Netta, because I know you know exactly the situation here, but some people, I can't tolerate those questions very well from, I feel very insulted, especially if they come at me with a kind of an attitude that seems to suggest that I'm not looking at the big picture here, you know. I looked at the big picture from every angle for 7 years, so I know all about the picture. And autonomy and sexual self-determination have absolutely no place within it. Even the notion, the idea that there is some kind of sexual freedom in prostitution, it should very obviously fly in the face of the facts, even for a person who's never experienced a moment of prostitution. The whole point of prostitution, and I have to preface this by saying it's not possible to be truly honest about prostitution without being somewhat graphic. I'm not talking about being unnecessarily vulgar, but there will be times when I have to be graphic. The reality of prostitution involves having every single orifice of your body available to anybody who can afford to insert their penises, fingers, fists, you know, vibrators, bottles, you know, you name it, into you. There is no self-determination in that at all. And the overwhelming experience of prostitution, the most common experience in prostitution, was being on the receiving end of somebody else's dominant sexual fantasies. Whether they were, and wherever they were on the scale, all the way up to extreme violence, right the way down to something that was very gently but deliberately suggested. Everywhere on that scale, you were dealing with dominance, so of course you were in the position of being passive, and you had no choice in that. There is an old expression that I've used in the book, he who pays the piper calls the tune. I don't know if you use that here in Norway, but we say it at home, and it's very true. If you go into a cafe for a cup of coffee and they put sugar in the coffee that you didn't ask for, you're paying for that coffee. So you expect a cup of coffee to be taken away and come back to you, no sugar, you know. Prostitution, because it exists in this capitalist system, operates in exactly the same way. And there's no happy hookers in that, there's no high class hookers, there's no autonomy, and there's certainly no sexual self-determination.
Thank you. When we were campaigning for the law here in Bergen in Norway, and especially for the last 8 years that went up to 2007, we were using a French filmmaker, Hubert War film, documentary film. He made the films on the brothels in Amsterdam, he made films with the Johns, he made films, Grace, the Nigerian young girl who were trafficked, she was trafficked from Nigeria to Paris. And he also made the first film from East to West, trafficking of East European women into Western Europe. And he says in his last film, when he is, he says, I had never come across any happy hooker. And he does his film with no hidden camera. So those who have, yeah. So there are some voices, serious voices, and you are. And what we have to say here that you are joining that force. That there are not many voices that are saying the truth and taking it from their own life or the reality. And Rachel, you are the first one here that we have here in Bergen that really shares with us in your own capacity and in your own name and not hiding behind any mask.
Mm.
And that is a great inspiration for us to see that slowly the society are becoming more open. Is it more possible to exit prostitution?
Well, first of all, what I feel is that there is something afoot in the world, definitely. Because in the last, about 18 months ago, myself and a collection of Irish women got together, all of us with experience in prostitution, and we formed a group called SPACE, which stands for Survivors of Prostitution Abuse Calling for Enlightenment. Now, and what we found out is that we'd actually been working individually since 2010, which was a funny thing because we didn't know about each other, we never heard of each other. But you know, over time we started to pick up little snippets about each other through the media. So I approached a friend of mine who works in an outreach centre in Dublin, and I put out the call that I wanted us to start organising on a more kind of official level. So we did that. And I really do believe what happened since then was I started to spend more and more time online trying to reach out to the women. And I found that there were women all over the world. And I really do believe that there has been a time, for whatever reasons, I don't know, but maybe there's a time for everything in this world. And I think that the time has come where we need to start rejecting what has been the gender inequality that has lasted just for countless centuries. I just would like to make one point about your last question, Yvette. You asked me whether or not prostitution was a function of choice, or whether it could ever be considered that way. I forgot to say to you that for me, prostitution is very obviously not a function of choice, and it couldn't be. Because if you look at the social demographics of the prostituted people in the world, and you see where they're coming from, people who are extremely socially disadvantaged for the most part, and dealing with all of the social spin-off disadvantages that come from that, you know, educational disadvantage, homelessness, addiction, destitution, and so on and so forth. It's a nonsense to say that it's a choice. If your choice is, as mine was, between prostitution and going back to a public park bench to spend the night, well, then you don't have a choice.
That brings us directly to the debate that we see here in our daily newspapers. This is the 23rd of May. A young man in Civita is a think tank, conservative. He says, sex workers also have choice. And that is so. That's why it's so important that you are here saying it. I will just go back to the SPACE International, the new organization that you have launched, which is an extremely rare thing. And we have been fighting for the law and have been telling advocacy for having good exit program for women and men in prostitution. We haven't had you on board because there are no such survivor-led organization in Norway. So could you please say some more words about why it is so important to have survivors in the forefront of the political struggle that we are doing towards a better society?
I believe that it's crucially important to have survivor leadership in any human rights struggle that you're talking about, no matter what it is. You know, it would be ludicrous to try to fight for the rights of any group without taking on board the opinions of the group who know what it is to have those very same rights taken away. And if you look at any struggle that's ever existed in the history of liberation on earth, you know, it's that doesn't change, it's always the same. None of that means to say, of course, that us survivors don't need and appreciate our allies, because we need them very badly and we appreciate them very much. But I think that what needs to happen in the world is that we need to work together. Survivors and programs and groups, you know, there needs to be a coalition of people and groups working together to abolish the right to buy another human being for the purposes of sexual gratification. And I think that that's best done as a team effort. But to get back to your question, why is the survivor leadership, that's important because so many lies are told about what prostitution truly involves. And the weight of shame is so heavy that most people affected by prostitution will never come forward. For my part, it certainly isn't because I think that I'm some kind of a superhuman person. It's just that I am so frustrated with the lies and I'm so sick of it. And if we don't start coming forward, as I've been saying to the girls back home, it's not until we start stepping out publicly and saying, yeah, here's my face, here's my name, and what have you got to say about it? Because it's not until we do that that we're going to start making progress here.
Another aspect of the importance of having a survivor-led organization into the debate is that you are very conscious about how to express yourself. For example, I have learned that I don't say that you are a prostitute. It's nothing that you are. We should say you are a prostituted woman. Something has been done to you. And that can also be done, du er ikke en prostituert, du er en kvinne, hvordan blir det på norsk da? Ja, jeg skal tenke litt på det.
Kvinne som driver med prostitusjon.
Ja, and the other thing is that this headline was sex workers also do make choices. Can you, sex work, can you explain why we should not use such a term?
Okay. I had this discussion in front of the Irish politicians a couple of months ago, and we presented our evidence at the committee because Ireland is now debating whether or not to follow the lead of Norway, Sweden and Iceland, which we of course are hoping and praying that they will. But I prefaced what I said that day by asking the government members please not to refer to us as sex workers. Because to me, I to be frank, would rather be called a whore any day of the week than a sex worker. Because at least as offensive as the term whore is, there is at least some honesty in it. There is no honesty whatsoever in the term sex worker. Sex work and sex worker are terms that came out of the American pro-prostitution movement in the 70s. they were deliberately constructed terms, and the whole point of them was to sanitize and normalize prostitution in the public view. And they have been quite successful in doing that, actually. Those terms now are often used. I was on a radio show only a few weeks ago in Ireland, and I was referred to as a sex worker, and of course I had to have the conversation again. And I keep on having it until people stop using that term around me. In 7 years of prostitution that spanned the entire sex trade, from the streets right up to the escort agencies and everywhere in between, I never met a woman who referred to herself as a sex worker, ever. And I've heard the term over and over, and in political discourse, in academic circles, in the media, but I never heard it in the brothels. And I never heard it on the street corners, and I never heard it anywhere where it might have been used, were it any kind of a legitimate term. That term needs to go straight in the bin. And, you know, one point that I've made a couple of times now is that people are very often, well-intended people are very often sucked into that terminology in a well-meaning attempt not to cause offence. But to any woman who has her political marbles all lined up straight in her head, it will cause a great deal of offence.
Yes, we used, when the International Labour Union proposed in 1993 that the countries in Southeast Asia should legalize sex work and sort of recognize it as work. Then we, the women's movement here in Bergen, gave us a big chance to start communicating with the trade unions. That was the inroad, so to say, that we got the trade union, the female-dominated trade unions, on board first. So I hope that you in Ireland also use that debate over the wordings to approach the labor union. But that we will talk about later. I have another question for you. I have read the book. I said it was a memoir, but it is also a philosophical book. And you really have to read the sentence to grasp, to follow your meanings and to see how you discuss with yourself and then in the end come up with your opinion and solutions. And I was so when I came over those 10 pages where you talk about the relationship between pornography and prostitution, it's so rare that there's anyone else than the women's movement, the feminists, who talks about the relationship between pornography and prostitution. And could you please tell us a little bit more how you come about to take that, give it such a prominent part of your book?
Well, for me, prostitution, because I worked in photographic porn as a young teenager. I also worked as a stripper. And I think, I worked in almost every area of the sex trade that I've ever heard of, with the exception of I was never a lap dancer. so I, you know, nearly did the full round. So I know what it is to be at the wrong end of the camera. I know how that feels. And I know that pornography is only prostitution with a camera pointed at it. That's all it is, you know? And if somebody, let's say, commits some other type of a crime, regardless what that crime may be, let's think of something then silly, like, let's say, shoplifting, okay? You're robbing a block of cheese. Does anybody think that because there's a camera pointed at you robbing that block of cheese that you haven't robbed the block of cheese, and that it's in fact all a fantasy or some kind of entertainment for the person holding the camera and for the people that will then go on to view you robbing the block of cheese? Do you know, there is a serious problem with people who view pornography and don't see it for what it is. And the problem is that everything has turned into entertainment in our world. It's very strange. And when it comes to the issue of pornography, I read a really interesting opinion recently, and I'm pretty certain it was by C.S. Lewis. I must look into that, because I was very surprised to hear him talking about pornography. But anyway, he said that, he made the parallel. Let's suppose he was talking about strip clubs, and he said, let's suppose we had some kind of clubs where people went along to, and he said, now, you know, human sexuality, it's there for a reason, it's a very enjoyable thing, we all enjoy it, unless there's something wrong with us, that's great. But let's imagine that there was some kind of a club that we went along to where we just watched racks and racks of ribs and steaks sizzling away, and the whole idea was to go in and just have a good go at them and salivate while you're looking at the food cooking it. You know, and he said, I would suggest then that there was something very wrong in the mentality and the attitude towards food of any person who went to those type of clubs. And I laughed and I said, well, that's so true. There's something wrong in the basic structure of pornography. There's something very sick and twisted about the idea that it's okay to view another person being molested in these ways and take pleasure out of it and just happily assume that that's perfectly fine with them. I'll tell you a brief story. One of the girls in our group was gang raped in prostitution about 5 years ago, 5 or 6 years back. Herself and a friend of hers had agreed to go along and serve as 5 men. When they got there were 8 men, and so they did what they'd gone there to do for a few hours. And about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, they decided that, okay, time was up, you know, they were going home. The men turned around and told them that they weren't going anywhere, that they weren't finished yet. I'll find this a little bit emotional, so apologies. Anyway, what happened that night, both of those women walked out of there the next morning. Covered in semen and urine and spit and blood and everything else you wouldn't want to be covered in. One of them survived, one of them died. A matter of weeks later, of a drug overdose. And when my friend first told that story, I was in so much pain, because she said, she finished up the story by saying, it was, she died of a drug overdose, but I know what really killed her. And the reason why I'm so emotional right now is because it brings back so much of what I saw as a teenager and a young woman in prostitution. And there were so many tragedies. But the reason why I tell that story is because my friend said to me, she was trying to reason what happened that night out with somebody, and she was saying, I just don't understand why, and you know, they turned into animals, and they didn't even look like human beings. They weren't looking at us, they were looking straight through us. It was like we weren't even human. So somebody said to her, look, you know, that is such a regular image in porn. It's the predominant image now. So she, in the course of the conversation, the name of a website came up, a regular website now, not a regular porn site, I should say, not a hardcore, just regular. So in she went, and she said that the very first video that came up was 2 women being raped by 8 men. Mm. She said she just wanted to vomit. So that is one of the God knows how many reasons I have for having a very serious issue with porn. Women in prostitution are in the front lines when it comes to the type of twisted fantasies that porn inflames.
Yes, Rachel just described how pornography shapes men's male sexuality, and what can we do about that?
Well, that's simple. We can do what the Icelandic people did. We can ban it. You know, there's a lot of people out there, not in this room, I'm not suggesting, but there's a lot of people out there who are not going to like the sound of that. Well, tough luck. That's what God gave you an imagination for. Go on and run wild with it. It doesn't need to involve hurting anybody else. And, you know, I really do believe that this is, it's right back to the issue of gender equality. If you go looking at pornography, and I'd advise everybody to read, everybody who hasn't read Gail Dines' Pornland to read it, you look at the predominant images, and look at the ones that come up over and over and over again. They are always, almost always, about the degradation of women. It's a sexualized form of contempt. That's what it is. There was a case that I've only just Facebooked all over the place, only came back up in the last couple of days, of a 12-year-old boy who'd been watching pornography around the clock on his iPad or whatever it was, and he raped a 4-year-old girl. This is in Britain. The evidence that we have that pornography is damaging to humanity generally, and particularly to women, is overwhelming. Some people don't want to look at it, but that doesn't mean it's not there.
Thank you. I will go back to where we started about choice, and I will ask you a question. What are then the key social conditions that led to women and children being vulnerable to commercial sexual exploitation?
I think the best way to answer that is to talk about the girls that I would have met when I was 15, 16. In the first couple of years, like I said, I worked for 7 years. I worked from 91 to 98. And about two and a half years after I started in prostitution, I started off as a street worker. A law was enacted in Ireland that made it illegal to loiter with the intention of either buying or selling sex. So we were run off the streets, most of us, in the winter of 93. But up to that point, without exception, all of the young girls I met on the streets were girls who I had already known from the residential care system, or they were girls who'd been introduced to me through another girl I knew from the residential care system. One girl I'd met when I was in a juvenile detention centre for the under 18s. Every last one of these girls came from backgrounds of extreme dysfunction. You're talking about alcoholism in the parents, heroin addiction, very often physical abuse, but most often sexual abuse. You know, the majority of those girls had been sexually abused, and one girl in particular, I remember her just laughing and saying to me, you know, I may as well be out here selling it as having my stepfather take it away for free. And then people talk about choice, you know. There is no choice in selling what's already been stolen from you. It's gone anyway. That's the attitude of a lot of these young women. And so those key conditions, they're always about backgrounds of dysfunction. I mean, I came from a background of dysfunction. Both of my parents were seriously affected by mental illness. My mother was schizophrenic and my father was bipolar. And he committed suicide in the winter of 89, and I was out of the house within a couple of months of that time. I'd only just turned 14 by a couple of weeks. And so I went to live in a hostel, and then began the experience of going from place to place to place, and that was interspersed with periods of absolute homelessness where I'd be out on the streets under the stars, bounced all over the residential care system. And I believe that my life prior to prostitution primed me for prostitution. You know, I was as broke as you can be. I was homeless, I was friendless, I had no family. And so questions about choice infuriate the hell out of me, to be honest with you, because I had no viable choice. And this is what people need to understand. There's a very big difference between having a choice and having a viable choice. Yes, I had the choice to go back and sit down on that park bench, but what was viable about that choice? Nothing.
Yes.
read that
bill? Yes.
I'm just going to read a page that addresses the issue.
I should say first that what about the myth that women have control over prostitution?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Yes.
This is a subject that you could go into about at least a dozen different angles, so I won't exhaust the issue to death.
No.
But there is one aspect of control, they say, in prostitution, that a woman has control. No, she doesn't. Because, like I said earlier on, the purpose and the whole point of the exchange is so that the dominant party is the one who's in control. So, no, there's no control. I was confusing this with choice, by the way. I'm going to read this page that demonstrates, I think, at least about the way we didn't have any sexual control. There was always something a prostitute was unwilling to do, some threshold over which she would not willfully allow a client to go. These were our choices, or our attempts at choices, because we all suffered outright sexual molestation, which obviously, in those instances, nullified any choices we attempted to make. Often a man would molest a woman in exactly the way he knew she least wanted to be molested, to maximise his own sadistic pleasure, of course. It was not difficult for a man to ascertain this. In the 1990s, all he had to do was ask her what she was willing to do or not to do, either on the street, over the phone, or when he was alone with her in a hotel or brothel's bedroom. These days, it's even easier. He'll know her boundaries before he lays eyes on her, because it will say so on her profile page posted on the brothel's website. So yes, some men who try to justify their use of prostitutes will use the fact that women say no to certain sex acts as evidence that it is the women who are in control here. But it is flawed evidence. It is either misguided on the part of a man or it is a clumsy attempt at lying. I can say from my own experience and from witnessing the experiences of many others that prostitutes attempt to create boundaries on the sexual act based on personal sexual thresholds over which it is simply too sickening to go. This meant for me only that a penis in my mouth was less sickening than in my vagina, not that it was not sickening at all. And since we did, and we certainly did, accept for ourselves that which was sexually sickening, could we possibly be said to have been in control? Accepting the sexually sickening on a reduced level is part of the lot of the walking prostitute. I could not count the times I've heard this discussed in prostitution. These boundaries exist as an attempt to create a barrier between the prostitute and the intolerable experience of having her body used in every imaginable way. It is a typical strategy used by prostitutes to remove themselves from the fullness of their reality. It is disassociation manifesting in a physical sense. To use this strategy as evidence of prostitutes' control is to misunderstand and misrepresent the reason for the existence of these boundaries. We did not attempt to erect boundaries in prostitution because we were in control of it. We attempted to erect boundaries in order to be able to stand it. And if you need to erect barriers between yourself and a situation in order to be able to stand it, that is a situation in which you are most assuredly not in control.
I have not many questions left. We have 10 minutes before we go over to the next part. But Rachel, you... I want you to speak a little bit about the Nordic model, but before we do that, I will just say that Rachel also is and her organization is an activist in the islands movement to have the law that criminalizes the buying of sexual acts, what we call the Nordic model, and you can note down this. The name of the organization is Turn the Red Light Off, with two S in the end. And if you Google that, you will come into a very nice website, and it will be of importance, I think, that we link up with them and say hello. Now we be partners or whatever. And the other questions I have here, what will it take to end prostitution forever? Can you sort of mix those questions together in your answer?
I'll try. What I think it will take to put an end to prostitution forever is enlightenment, real enlightenment, a depth of enlightenment that you would need to take to the spiritual. We have to really fully engage with what prostitution truly is. First of all, we have to stop accepting the watered-down prostitution-light version that we're being fed through the media and the entertainment world. There are no pretty women in prostitution, put it that way. You know, we need to be enlightened as to understand what it truly feels like. And it's very difficult for any one of us, including myself, to truly put ourselves in another person's shoes and try to imagine what it is that they've experienced if we haven't experienced it ourselves. But we have to try, because until we do, we're just never going to get rid of this. We're never going to be able to free ourselves of prostitution until we're enlightened as to what it truly involves for the people who have to live it. And I can tell you, and I should add, that every woman I ever met in prostitution had her own little kind of tricks that she would use in order to remove herself from the experience. And we often discussed these tricks, little tunes we would hum in our head, things that we would imagine and think about while involved in the act. It was all about removing yourself from your own body. And if you're in any situation where you need to remove yourself from your own body, you're not the problem, the situation is, you know? So it's, yeah, well, we do believe, Agneta, that enlightenment is what it's going to take. And that's why we're called survivors of prostitution abuse, calling for enlightenment, space for short. Because we believe that we have to have that enlightenment first before we have anything else. And we work in conjunction with the group that Agneta has just mentioned. It's called Turn Off the Red Light. You can find that.
Turn Off the Red Light, yes.
Yeah, little correction there. turnofftheredlight.ie. Now the second part of the question was to talk a little bit about how we feel about the Nordic model.
Yeah.
Well, we've been keeping a close eye on Norway, that's for sure, with what's going on here politically. It's very, very important to us in Ireland that Norway does not revoke its law. I couldn't tell you how important that is to us, because what we're trying to do is to push our leaders to take their leadership from Norway, Sweden and Iceland. Now, if any one of those countries revokes the decision that they've made, it puts us in a weaker position. Apart from anything else, I find it upsetting. This country has made the right choice. Now what it needs to do is follow that up with resources to the police and resources to women who want to forge a different life. It needs to strengthen the law that it's made, not dismantle it. But we are hugely in support of the Nordic law, and we won't accept anything less in our country. And myself and the other members of Space International have decided that it doesn't matter what it takes, we don't care. If we have to push for decades, we will not stop pushing until we get this law. So we just so much appreciate the assistance of the Norwegian people in trying to preserve what they've done with this law. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll just add a comment to what you said, that told us that we have to it's difficult to know what prostitution is when you haven't been in it, but you have to imagine. We have to do that task to think. And that the first thing is to read your book. But you said that you and your friend, that you sometimes you were discussing how the different methods each of you had how to detach from your body. And I would just say that. Think, do some thinking. Think about who else do when, in what situation do people detach from their body? Think. Those who are tortured, political torture, they tell about how they endured and how they detached from their body. That is something. And
Chico Ali and I went to Tanzania in April, and we are working with activists in the villages on female genital mutilation. And there were one woman, an activist in the village, came up to us, and she suddenly told this story that she was taken from her home at I don't know if it was 6 or 12, I don't know, and sent to another village. Her mother took her there, and she understood that something was going to happen, and suddenly she went into she was forced into a hut, and they laid her down, and they started to do female genital mutilation on her, and she screamed her head off. And suddenly I went calm and told them, you don't have to force me down. You don't have to put me there on the floor. I will lay here still. And then she said, I went up and the things were done to me. That is to be detached from your body. As you are.
Yes, that's it's powerfully evocative for me, that story. I can tell you every last bit of sex that was ever done to me in prostitution, I was up in the corner of the room. I wasn't in the bed. Mm-hmm. And the last thing I'd like to read here from the book is a short quote from Australian academic Sheila Jeffries from her book, The Idea of Prostitution. I've used it to preface one of the chapters. She says, the practice of dissociation which prostituted women employ to protect their sense of self from violation is so similar to the dissociation employed by sexually abused children that it provides good evidence that the two experiences are similarly abusive. And I remember when I came across that quote, because I had done a lot of thinking about dissociation, because it was such a very common practice and it was so often discussed in lots of different ways. In prostitution, sometimes women would say, I'm talking about working class Dublin women who'd be like, you know, rough around the edges, and they would talk about their experiences sometimes in very vulgar terms, but sometimes they'd say stuff like, he was a horrible, rough, smelly, you know, fucker, and it's just as well I was floating out the window the way you do be, you know, yourself. And I made the point in the book that that term, you know yourself, I don't know if you use it here, but it's a very common Dublin term. And it obviously means, I expect you to understand what I'm talking about, like you know as well as I do, that kind of thing. And it was so often used when we discussed the harmful, degrading nature of the work that we were doing, that it was universally expected that we would all understand. So this is one of the many reasons why I get so intensely frustrated and very angry at times when I listen to this pro-prostitution whitewash that says that, oh yes, there may be some women who find it traumatic, but they're a very small kind of it. And I would say, hang on a minute, well, where were all the happy hookers when I was on the game? Because I never met one. So where were they all hiding? You know, what you're listening to in the media, you're listening to it for a reason, from the Happy Hooker Brigade. It is much, much easier to walk out in public and say, I'm fine, I'm happy, thank you very much. You don't know anything about my area of life. I'm happy, I'm autonomous. Now toddle on and leave me alone and mind your own business. It is so much easier to say that than it is to sit telling the truth with the tears pouring down your face. And that's why the opposition has a stronger voice. But if we have anything to do with it, that situation won't be lasting for long, because we are already expanding globally. We have women on board now from America, from Britain. I'm talking to women from France. I would deeply love to get a couple of in touch with some women here in Norway. And we've only just started to organise. So I don't think that the happy hooker is going to be the prevailing voice.
Rachel, now you can sit back and relax, and we will call upon
some people that we have asked to come here tonight and address you on the topic of the Nordic model. And while someone put the chairs on the... I will call upon Jette Christensen from the Labour Party and Marta Hammer from the Socialist Left Party. And while you are finding your seat, I will just say that to you, Rachel, about them, that and Berlin. The youth branches of each of these parties, the Labour Party and Social Left Party, played an extremely important role in pushing for the law here in Norway. The youth branches of these two parties were played an important part in pushing for the law in Norway. We are now in the spring of 2007, I don't remember, 2007, I think, when we had the upcoming party conference in each mother branches in Oslo. And the youth branches of the Labour Party and the Social Left Party on each of them convinced the older generation in the chapter here in Bergen and in the county that the mother branches should demand that the law should be put on the agenda when the party conference were about to be in March and April. So they gained that. The parties here in Bergen, Hordaland, sent along to the Oslo that we demand that the law that criminalized the buying of sex and put on the agenda on our respective party conference. And the rest is history, you know. But these were not the younger generation then, but they were in the mother parties, and they are feminists, here, very important feminists here in Berlin. And we would like to give the first Jette to speak. Yes? Thank you for coming. Oops.
Thank you so much. I was not in the mother party then, but I am now. And I just have to say thank you so much, Rachel. You have no idea how much it means to us that you are here, and most importantly that you're here right now, because that you couldn't have chosen a more important time, because we have an election coming up, and there are young men running for office under the main cause, and one of their main causes is to take away this law, and that is extremely frustrating for us. Not only because we were pro the law and we worked hard together to put the law in place, but also being against the law is one thing, but removing it, it's a whole different story, and no country's ever done that. And what is the message we're then sending out, you know? I'm sorry, I'm not as good in English as you are. Because when we placed the law, it was supposed to have two effects. One was to build attitudes. It was the society's way of saying, no, it is not allowed to use money to buy yourself access to another human being's body. That is against the law in Norway. What are we saying to the men in Norway? What are we saying to the women in Norway, what are we saying to ourselves if we say, no, on the other hand, we regret, now it's supposed to be legal again. Because when we placed the law, there was also lots of action to take to help women out of prostitution. Because if it wasn't a package along with it, we could never have had put on the law. Every year since the law has been working, there's been giving 10 million Norwegian kroners for helping women out of prostitution within different different ways, and also supporting different organizations. And that is the most important thing that we do for the women that are prostituted, but to help them out of it. And it's also, but still saying that it's not allowed to buy another person's human being is something that we are doing for the for the women that find themselves in prostitution, but also what we do to build a society and what thoughts we have in society. Because I was really, when you started to speak about the sex worker term, we have had a debate about that in Norway many times. And that is why I said that it's so important that you raise your voice in Norway right now, because there has been, there have been several voices saying something else over many pages, or in many newspapers, in many TV shows, in many radio shows over the last year, claiming that they're not heard, claiming that they're not seen. But they are seen and shown. And even have almost, one of the biggest newspaper in Norway almost had his own, like five of one of these women telling her story. Even though we have numbers saying in Norway that 98% of the women that find themselves in prostitution are forced to it, either if it's by violence or by economical situation or by a psychological situation. But still, they are the ones that are speaking out loud, and that's why we really, really need your voice here now, Rachel. That is really important, because, as I said earlier, what are the consequences for a country that turns the law around? It's not long ago that we read stories about Germany, young women who came to seek for unemployment, who were unemployed, wanted to get a job, and they were sent to a brothel because it is looked upon as a job. And if they didn't take the job in the brothel, they wouldn't get unemployment help. You know? And that is not a situation that we want, because as you so perfectly put it, it is not work. It is something so much different in that. And especially if we can walk out of here and have an agreement about on how we can organize, that is the most important thing, because all the others are so organized. The opposition is so incredibly organized, within movie making, within writing essays. I mean, they can package their message in so many ways, and it's worldwide. And we really have to step up, and we really, really need to start that job right now. So thank you so much for being here, Rachel.
Thank you, Rachel, for coming, telling us our your story, and coming to promote your book, because as Jette here said, we need that voice. The group pro-prostitution lobby, they get a lot of time and space in the media, also in Norway. And it seems to be a very, very nice way to get into the newspaper with that part of the story. In May, 5th of May, we have the latest one, one that was being prostituted. She's been in the media for a long time, and now she said she that was a stripper in Norway. She said she'd been a prostitute for many years, and she's also attacked the laws, both this law, but also the law. Yes. The way of working for getting the law is really started because Norway wasn't the first. It was Sweden who got in front. And many of we feminists, we look to Sweden because they have always had a bit of better feminist organization. We think they are stronger, they're better organized. They also got a lot of good feminists in the academia. And they did this good work of getting this law. And after they got it, then we were a lot of some young feminists, some older, and from different parties who said, this is what we have to work for. This is a good law. And also, what's a good thing for in Sweden was that they had the police working with them also from the beginning. So it was a good example to look to Sweden and say, this is what we in Norway have to do as well. I was a member of the Socialist Left Party's youth organization at that time, and we were quite a many in that organization working for this. And it's very nice, and I'm very glad to have you here in Bergen. I didn't live in Bergen at that time, but I live in Bergen now. But the feminists from Bergen and here in Hordaland, they were always in front, in Norway. Not only in my party, but also in the Labour Party, because it's they started many of these fight. Not of course, they were not the only one, but there's many initiatives were taken from here. And in my party, Hordaland Socialist Left Party were first to say we will have this law, and then we. My opinion from the debate in Norway is that yes, there are most of the people in Norway, they are against the prostitution. But the main argument against the law was that it will make the life much worse for those who are in prostitution. That's the main argument which I think uses now. Everyone is using it now, they're trying to use it all the time. And if the law is taken away, I'm quite sure it's that argument that will be the same. So that's why it's very good to have your voice here saying it's a good law. It's also so that something is very good in Norway, which I also think is better than in Iceland. Is that the police here also defend it. They say, yes, this law is a good way of having a fight for against trafficking in Norway. The pimp law is a good way of fighting prostitution and trafficking in Norway. We need all these kinds of law. But of course, that's not everything. And yet, as she told it, we have to do more to help those in prostitution to get out of it. There we can do a lot more. But we also, I also think we should say something about what is our impression, because the law has now been from 2007.
2009.
We did it in 2007. We haven't had any evaluation of the law yet, but it is about to come. But the government haven't given the evaluation to anyone yet, but it's about to come. And I'm quite sure that evaluation will be important. And it's of course very important how this kind of work will be done to try to get some kind of answer, how is this law really working. But the police is still defending it. It also is the expression that the demand in Norway is lower because there is a lot of men that don't want to buy sex because of the because they're afraid of being caught as a buyer of prostitution. And also, as Jette said, it says what's the Norwegian think it's okay. We don't think it's okay for men to buy women. So that's a very good for me, that's all. That's a good enough reason to have that law. But it, of course, we have to have other things as well to fight this industry.
Thank you, Marte Hammer, and thank you, Jette. I would just comment on, give some facts and figures. The, according to the Minister of Justice, the evaluation will be done in 2014, that next year. I don't think that the changement of the law will occur before after the evaluation. So we have, let's say, 1.5 years to build up stamina and prepare ourselves. The evaluation is going to be done here in Norway after 5 years. In Sweden, it took 10 years before they ever considered evaluation. So, to things to change is difficult. 5 years is not much. The thing about the argument that it will be worse for the women in prostitution. We have one lone speaker about that issue, and that is the Pro Center and the various reports. I will just remind you that the report that came out last in June 2012, and that which they are sort of referring to in the yellow report, says that after the law, the women in prostitution experienced more violence. They had to go back on that. And they had, if you go back to the Aftenposten, did a research on the report. Cluster Company did a research on the report, and then they interviewed Björk Nolli, and she had to admit, no, they could be either bet more than less. But this is, once you have sort of been able to do that lie, it lives its own life. But we have to say, hello, remember what you said in Aftenposten and in Klassekampen in July last year. Yes, okay. We'll start, Rudolf Dottersen. I will present you for, I will tell Rachel Moran a little bit about you. Because you have a concrete experience with the law here in Bergen, and you are always willing to stand up in the media and tell about what you know, media being newspaper or the television. And you also always stress the importance of the law. And I just here have some examples of what you have been saying, and I would just remind you what you said in the human trafficking conference about where to have the most profits. Okay, thank you for coming.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you for your speak. Jeg har vært i retten i flere dager nå, så jeg har ikke hatt anledning til å lage en presentasjon på engelsk, så jeg håper dere skal tilgi meg at jeg velger å snakke på norsk.
Veldig greit for oss.
Jeg begynte å jobbe med menneskehandel i 2008. Da fikk jeg min første menneskehandelssak. Den har vært mye omtalt i media, og TV2 lagde også en dokumentar om den saken. Den handler om en 17 år gammel albansk jente som ble utnyttet i prostitusjon her i Bergen. Her i Bergen så kjøpte altså menn, voksne menn, seksuelle tjenester fra et mindreårig barn. Noe av det som kanskje sjokkerte meg mest i den saken der var at, og det er viktig å huske på at dette var i 2008, forbud for sexkjøploven, var at det var en sak som var veldig vanskelig å etterforske. Jenta nekta for at hun var prostituert. Hun nekta for at de menneskene, eller de tre personene som vi hadde pågrepet, hadde gjort henne noen ting som helst. Hun nekta for at de utnyttet henne. Hun nekta for at de hadde voldelig mot henne. Og hun nekta, som sagt, i det hele tatt for at hun hadde drevet med prostitusjon. Vi var derfor avhengige av, eller det ville i hvert fall vært stor hjelp for oss i etterforskningen, hvis menn i Bergen som hadde kjøpt seksuelle tjenester av denne jenta, hadde vært villige til å stå fram. Og vi gikk også ut i media og etterlyste og fortelte om dette. Det var ingen menn som stod fram og fortelte om dette. Selv om det hadde vært stor hjelp for oss i etterforskning, og dette var på et tidspunkt hvor det fremdeles var lovlig og ikke straffbart å kjøpe seksuelle tjenester i Norge. Så har vi vært historien at vi klarte å skaffe nok bevis i saken. Vi fikk alle de tre mennene dømt, til tross for at denne jenta vitnet både i tingretten og i lagmannsretten, og fastholdt sine forklaringer om at hun ikke var prostituert, og at vi ikke hadde gjort henne noen ting som helst. Så går det 4 år, eller det går helt frem til i fjor høst, og da får jeg et brev fra denne jenta i Albania, sender brev opp hit, hvor hun skriver: «Tusen takk for at du ikke trodde på meg. Fortell at du var prostituert. Fortell det at hun ble rekruttert i en alder av 13 år, utnyttet i prostitusjon i Hellas først, deretter i Italia, før hun ble transportert til Norge og Bergen, hvor hun utnyttet da det sist, før Bergens politiet da slo til, og vi pågrepte av de tre mennene som hadde utnyttet henne og ble fri. En tankevekkende historie, det tok henne, altså hun, det var en krevende etterforskning, men det var altså ingen som valgte å stå frem og hjelpe politiet i den etterforskningen. Jeg er en stor tilhenger av sexkjøploven, av mange grunner. For det første fordi at det er noe grunnleggende galt, det er feil å kjøpe seksuelle tjenester og redusere kvinnen til et seksuelt objekt. Jeg tror at det aller, aller viktigste signalet med sexkjøploven er at han er moral, han skaper moralske holdninger mot sexkjøp. Jeg diskuterte sexkjøploven med han som er leder for overkrimseksjonen i Oslo, og han fortalte at etter sexkjøploven trådte i kraft, så har det vært en kraftig reduksjon i antall av unge menn som kjøper sex i Norge. Det er kanskje den aller, aller viktigste effekten av sexkjøploven, nemlig det at han skaper moralske holdninger hos den oppvoksende generasjonen. Jeg har ingen tro på, ingen illusjoner om at godt vokste menn, eldre menn, at sexkjøploven har noen effekt i forhold til de holdningene som de har i forhold til kjøp av seksuelle tjenester. Det har ingen tro på at den har noen effekt i forhold til den gruppen. For det er disse holdningene som inngått over så lang tid. Jeg hadde den aller første. Det systemet i Norge er jo slik at hvis du ikke vedtar en forelegg, så bringer saken inn for domstolen, så blir det dom, kan du eventuelt bli domfelt for forholdet. Og det samme gjelder jo da ved kjøp av seksuelle tjenester, hvor man da får en bot. Og hvis man nekter å vedta boten, så blir saken brakt inn for domstolen. Jeg hadde den første saken som ble brakt inn for en domstol i Norge. Det var en mann, han var 79 år, og han hadde kjøpt seksuelle tjenester av en jente, og han nekta for å gjøre det. Vi førte bevis for dette i retten, og så spurte jeg han. Han sier det at, ja, men hun likte det jo. Og så sier jeg til han at, du er 79 år, denne jenten du har kjøpt seksuelle tjenester av er knapt 21 år. Hva bygger du det på når du sier at hun likte det hun gjorde? Hva er det som gjør at du forklarer det? Så sier han at jo, men hun smilte jo hele tiden. Og da tror jeg vi er litt av kjernen i mye av de holdningene som preger de mennene som kjøper seksuelle tjenester. De lager en forklaring for seg selv som legitimerer at de kan gå ut og kjøpe seksuelle tjenester, og mange argumenterer jo med at jeg får det jeg vil ha, Kvinnen får penger, det trenger hun, hun får det hun har. Vi er begge fornøyd med den handelen. Jeg tror det er en holdning som preger veldig mange menn som kjøper seksuelle tjenester. For cirka et halvt år siden så ble politiets spesialgruppe her i Bergen, Exit, som jobber med menneskehandel og hallervirksomhet, oppsøkt av en nigeriansk jente. Hun fortalte at hun hadde jobbet som prostituert i Norge og i Spania i flere år. Og, men at hun var et offer for menneskehandel, at noen tvang henne til denne, at hun ble utnyttet, at alle pengene hun tjente måtte hun sende tilbake med henne i Spania. Vi spurte, sånn som vi alltid gjør, er det noen personer her i Norge som kontrollerer deg, som er voldelig mot deg? Er det noen som på en måte utøver alt, truer deg med noe? Er det noen som vi på en måte kan starte en etterforskning mot? Hvor skal vi starte? Og hun sa da, nei, det er ingen her i Norge. Ingen her i Norge som gjør meg noen kjøp noe. Jeg opererer her i Norge helt alene, men alle pengene jeg tjener meg sender tilbake med i Spanien. Og vi spurte, ja, men hvis det er slik at det er ingen her i Norge som hverken truer deg, er voldelig mot deg, eller gjør noen annen ting mot deg, hva er da årsaken til at du ikke går ut av dette? Hva er grunnen til at du fortsetter med å sende penger til de bakmennene i Spania? Og da forteller jeg at jo, det har seg sånn at de tok datteren min. Og når jeg hadde betalt de 50 000 euro, så ville jeg få datteren min tilbake. Den jenta, hun smilte fra morgen til kveld. Hun smilte til alle de kundene og til alle de mennene som var potensielle sexkjøpere. For hun visste det at jo mer kunder hun fikk, jo mer penger hun fikk betalt, jo mer hun tjente, jo mer hun sendte til bakmennene i Spania, jo raskere ville hun få nedbetalt lånet sitt, eller lånet og gjelden hun hadde, og jo raskere ville hun få datteren sin tilbake. Sånn at den holdningen som og den misforståtte oppfatningen som preger mange menn i forhold til de som kjøper seksuelle tjenester, det er mange tragiske skjebner bak de smilene som vi ser også på prostitusjonsarenaen her i Bergen. Jeg har en kompis av meg som jobber som politi i Sverige, i Stockholm, som også jobber i en spesialgruppe mot prostitusjon. Og vi utveksler en del artikler, intervjuer som vi finner faglig interessante. Og han sendte meg for noen uker siden et intervju med en svensk avis, som hadde intervjuet en tysk kriminalsjef, som hadde hovedansvar for alt som gikk på prostitusjon, menneskehandel, i en større tysk by. Og han hadde jobbet med dette i 15 år. Og som dere vet, så er det tillatt med salg av seksuelle tjenester, kjøp av seksuelle tjenester i Tyskland. Det er også godt organisert gjennom modellvirksomhet og så videre. Og han ble spurt om, denne tyske politisjefen ble spurt om han trodde, altså i prosent, hvor mange prostituerte av de som opererte i Tyskland, som var selvstendige, som faktisk var i stand til å ha kontroll over eget liv, og som styrte sin egen virksomhet. Når man da jobbet i en land hvor prostitusjon og kjøp av seksuelle tjenester var tillatt, og det også var tillatt med modellvirksomhet. Og han svarte, maks 2-3%. Maks 2-3%, og det bekrefter jo også det som hun sier. Det er også litt av hva vi tror, og hva den norske debatten går på. Dette med, som også vi snakket om, det happy hooker. Sant? De overklasse prostituerte som man tror gjør alt dette frivillig, og som styrer sin egen hverdag. I Tyskland var det fullt tillatt, også til det sosialt akseptert å kjøpe seksuelle tjenester. kun 2-3% mente han var det som gjorde dette, styrte sin egen plan. Sexkjøploven ble vedtatt i Sverige i 1999, altså 10 år før norske. I dag er det bred politisk enighet i Sverige om at det var sexkjøploven er riktig. Det var bred enighet om å beholde loven. Det er ikke tema å avskaffe loven. Og alle er enige fra nesten ytterst til høyre til ytterst til venstre, i hvert fall fra de store politiske partiene, om at loven har virket etter hensikten, og at han har en effekt. Derfor så, jeg har jobbet med dette feltet siden 2008, og det er nesten flaut, litt på flaut på vegne av politiet nå, å si at det gjør meg faktisk innen politi- og påtalemyndigheten til en av de mest erfarne innenfor dette området i politi- og påtalemyndigheten i Norge. Det sier litt om hvor lite kompetanse, hvor lite erfaring jeg egentlig har med dette. Og så starter man en debatt om å fjerne loven her i Norge, uten å ha evaluert den, og man kun har virket i 4 år. Men i hele tatt reiser debatten etter kun å ha latt loven virke i 4 år. For det er ingen tvil om at lovens effekt også har mye å si i forhold til hvor høyt man er på prioriteringslisten til politiet. Og politiet har mange vanskelige avveininger i forhold til hvorledes man skal prioritere ressursene. Men det betyr ikke at loven ikke virker av den måten. Men det sier liksom noe om hvorledes politiet også prioriterer. Trondheim er for eksempel den byen i Norge hvor det er gitt flest pålegg for kjøp av seksuelle tjenester. Men man må samtidig helt tilbake til 2006 for å finne en menneskehandeldom i Trondheim. Og de har bare hatt én dom. Bergen ligger ikke særlig høyt når det gjelder forelegg for sexkjøp. Men vi har likevel så har vi 50% av alle dommer for menneskehandel i Norge. Dette går også litt på hvordan politiet prioriterer hvordan man velger å bruke ressursene. Men det sier ingenting om altså antall utleggelser og antall forelegg for sexkjøp. Det sier ingenting om hvordan loven fungerer. Og, og her er ikke sexkjøploven enestående i så måte, men man ser på det samme når det gjelder for eksempel lovgivning i forhold til fartsovertredelser, promillekjøringer, narkotikabruk i Nygårdsparken. Alt er jo avhengig av politiets innsats mot de ulike gruppene. Men det er ingen som mener at vi skal avskaffe denne form for lovgivning, fordi om man for eksempel i en periode ikke har overtredelser, for alle vet at det er der likevel. Så min erfaring i alle fall at loven er riktig, at den har effekt, men først og fremst i forhold til de unge menn særlig, han virker moralskapende. Det har noe å si med hvorledes politiet prioriterer og følger opp disse lovbestemmelsene. Og det har noe å si på hvorledes samfunnet generelt jobber for å spre informasjon om loven. Her i Bergen så har Exit, altså politiets gruppe, gått sammen med Aftostiftelsen og lagt et undervisningsopplegg som vi tilbyr til alle videregående skoler i Bergen, hvor personer knyttet til Exit-gruppen kommer og holder foredrag om sexkjøp, menneskehandel og halvøksamhet i Bergen. Det har, tror vi, i hvert fall en viktig forhold til den oppvoksende generasjonen. Tror jeg stopper der, men jeg svarer gjerne.
Ok. I have a question for you, Udo. Not a question, but I want you to repeat what you said in the big conference on trafficking. You were looking at into the future, lots of the people that spoke, they were looking into the future, and you said that we have a global financial crisis, and there are many destitute people in the world, destitute poor young girls and women. and they are easily attracted to be willing to go up north. And Norway is a honeypot with the men with the money in their pocket. Those who, and there are the, that is one thing. We have a, the other thing is that the criminal organization are you know, profiting for this situation. And you were talking about that in the future we will see a rise in criminal organizations that are in drugs. We will see a rise in criminal organizations with theft and other crimes, and we also will see a rise in the criminal organizations that are trafficking women and controlling women. And then you said something about the profit. Can you repeat that? We have to hear that, because this is what we have to bring into the debate in Norway.
På verdensbasis så er det jo slik at menneskehandel er verdens nest største form for kriminalitet, målt i profit. Det er altså kun våpenhandel som genererer mer profit enn menneskehandel, og da fortrinnsvis mye knyttet til utnyttelse i prostitusjon. Så fortjenestepotensialet med å utnytte mennesker på denne måten er enormt høyt. Risikoen for å bli tatt er svært liten. Til illustrasjon så avsies det flere dommer på narkotika på en uke i Norge enn det det har blitt avsagt dommer på menneskehandel siden loven ble vedtatt i Norge siden i 2003. Altså i løpet av 10 år, og vi har hatt straffbestemmelsen om menneskehandel, og vi kan også gjerne ta med hallikbestemmelsen, så har det altså blitt avsagt færre dommer tilknyttet av disse to bestemmelsene enn det der avsies narkotikadommer på en uke. Samtidig så er profittpotensialet minst like høyt, sannsynligvis noe høyere, ved utnyttelse, altså ved rekruttering og utnyttelse av kvinner til prostitusjon. Og hvis du først er så uheldig å bli tatt, som bare et bittelite fåtal blir, så er sjansen for at du får noe, så vil straffenivået ligge vesentlig lavere. Til illustrasjon, hvis du for eksempel smugler inn 100 gram heroin til landet, så vil du få, så kan du tjene ca. 100 000 på det. Du vil få ca. 6 års fengsel. Men hvis du utnytter en kvinne i for eksempel 6 måneder, 3 måneder, 3 måneder, 4 måneder, 5 måneder, 6 måneder, og hun selger seksuelle tjenester til 3 eller 4 eller 5 menn hver eneste dag, og et samleie i verden koster 1500 kroner, så ser dere at profittpotensialet er vesentlig høyere på den virksomheten. Hvis man blir tatt, ja, den mindreårige jenta, albanske jenta, som de utnyttet av prostitusjon i Bergen var 17 år, der fikk de 3 års fengsel. Så det sier noe om, altså hvis man skal velge, hvis man gir sånn kriminellt perspektiv, hvilken kriminalitet man skal satse på, tjene mest mulig penger, lavest risiko for å bli tatt, og hvis man blir tatt, så lavest straff, eller ingen tvil om at man skal satse på å utnytte kvinner til prostitusjon.
Future if the law is taken back. We are sort of laying the Norway open for the profit makers of women's body. And thank you, but I will ask, we have the concluding remarks here now, and I would just ask you, Rachel, if you want to comment or say some final words to your guest.
I think the one thing that I suppose, if there's one note that I'd like to end it on, I would just like to say this, and I've discussed this with other women around the world before now. When I was in my early teens and I was a street robber, I used to often stand on the street and people would drive by, and sometimes they'd be very abusive and other times they wouldn't be. anything, much of anything at all, except they would really observe you, you know, they'd stare out the car window like, oh my God, there's one of those prostitutes type of thing. And it very much had the feeling of being in like an open air zoo for humans, you know. And I used to come back to a question in my mind, when the street was quiet, if you know, all the other girls were off, or I just got dropped back, or it was unusual that it was quiet, but when that happened, I would find myself coming back to this same question, and I would wonder, do you see me? You know, and that's what I used to ask when I, in my own mind, if somebody stared out the window of a car, and I would wonder, are there people in the world who are, now I was only 15, 16, so I was very, you know, innocent. And I wondered, were there people who were not within the sphere of prostitution, who were outside of it looking in, who knew instinctively that it was wrong? And basically that was my question when I asked, do you see me? You know? And even now, over 20 years later, it's such a relief to be in the company of people and have that feeling, oh my God, yes, there are people who do see me and see us, the us that we were back then, and the women who are still caught in that life. And especially to be around, you know, I guess people younger than I am, the next generation, coming up talking about how and why this is wrong, although you didn't have to live it to understand it. I can't tell you how much I appreciate that. So thank you.
Thank you.